Well, good morning again. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Okay, for those of you that weren't sure what the response was supposed to be, we'll give you a second chance. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. This is the highlight for the Christian life. This is the capstone of the entire Christian calendar, is Easter Sunday, because we celebrate the risen Lord, Jesus Christ. Just a couple of announcements I'd like to share with you as I ask the ushers to come forward this time. Mark your calendars for, we are having a missions conference, spring conference, which is not normal for us in time of year. We're looking forward to this on April 15th through 17th. Larry and Krista Lane will be our missionaries. We had to instruct our people in the back that when they speak, we cannot record it because they live in such a sensitive area of the world. Their life could be in danger if it somehow gets out. And so this is your only opportunity to hear from them would be live, because you won't be able to say, well, I'll watch it later on in the week. It won't be on public access television this time around. So that's on April 15th, 16th, and 17th. You'll be getting more information on those activities, but please start planning for that weekend. Other announcements are in your bulletin, so I'm just going to have you read those. I just want to let the governing board know that, yes, indeed, we are having a meeting, even though I'm leaving here fairly soon. We're still going to meet tomorrow night, so be aware of that. I look forward to seeing you there. Pastor Luke, would you come? Are you here? Oh, there you are. Yes, not guest host.
Let's pray. O God of my Exodus, great was the joy of Israel's sons when Egypt died upon the shore, but far greater the joy when the Redeemer's foe lay crushed in the dust. Jesus strides forth as the victor, conqueror of death, hell, and all opposing might. He bursts the bands of death, tramples the powers of darkness down, and lives forever. He, my gracious surety, apprehended for payment of my debt, comes forth from the prison house of the grave, free and triumphant over sin, Satan, and death. Show me herein the proof that his vicarious offering is accepted, that the claims of justice are satisfied, that the devil's scepter is shriveled, that his wrongful throne is leveled. Give me the assurance that in Christ I died, in him I rose, in his life I live, in his victory I triumph, in his ascension I shall be glorified. Adorable Redeemer, thou who wast lifted up upon a cross, art ascended to highest heaven. Thou, who as man of sorrows was crowned with thorns, art now as Lord of life, wreathed with victory. Once, no shame more deep than yours, no agony more bitter, no death more cruel. Now, no exaltation more high, no life more glorious, no advocate more effective. Thou art in the triumph car leading captive thine enemies behind thee. What more could be done than thou hast done? Thy death is my life, thy resurrection my peace, thy ascension my hope, and thy prayers my comfort. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. As we receive the offering this morning, I encourage you to celebrate our risen Lord.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. on and celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. He is risen. He is risen. And he lives forevermore. He is risen. He is risen. Come on and celebrate. Come on and celebrate. Come on and celebrate the resurrection of our Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt's pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. So glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Hallelujah. You may be seated. I am asking all the children, obviously you can't sit here today. Sit right there, right there. That's good. All the kids, little ones, come on down. I got a present for you if you come. How's that? However, adults, you have to stay where you are. Just for the kids. But I do need you to understand, kids, I need you to understand something. When you take back the gift I give you, you're not allowed to open it until your parents or guardians or grandparents, whoever you're sitting with, says so. Okay? So you get to have it, but they determine when you get to actually use it. Okay? All right. All right. So I thought, here's Easter Sunday. Who knows why we're here? Yep, we can celebrate about God. Yes. We can celebrate Jesus. Yes. He is risen. Good. Go ahead.
He has lived.
He has lived. He's still living, too. That's a great thing. Okay. We're celebrating he died, but also that he came back to life for us. So what I want to do is read this little book to you, okay? Sound good? Okay. And the name of the book is Easter, the Book of Colors. And so as I read this to you, you can look at the little tiny picture, or you can look at the one that's up there. Now, I got to tell you something. I got these props here to kind of let you visualize the colors. The problem is, I could not find a red tulip in the entire city of Hibbing. So, when we get to that part, just pretend they're red. Okay, so here's the story. Easter, the Book of Color, The Real Meaning of Easter by Glenda Palmer. Easter is more than white bunnies. Isn't this nice? Micah got this a long time ago when he was first born. Can you hear it? Where is that guy? Drove us crazy. But it's more than just white bunnies. It's more than white bunnies hopping on green grass. See the green grass right here? It's more than green grass next to red tulips, which I don't have, so we'll pretend these are tulips and they're red. Okay? Right? Someone had the idea of the red. I just heard it go off. They're more than red tulips under a blue sky. And there's the blue sky up here. They're more than blue sky with a yellow sun. What is more than a blue sky with yellow sun? Easter. Easter is more than yellow sun shining on a brown basket. Here's the brown basket. It's more than a brown basket filled with purple eggs. They're purple eggs, but the next part you're not going to see. It's more than purple eggs with orange polka dots. I don't got polka dots in mine. Easter is much more. And you guys just told me what it was. The first Easter was the day Jesus came back to life. Jesus is alive. And that is what Easter is all about. So happy Easter. Now I want you to do me something. Do me a favor, okay? I want you all to stand up. And I want you to get two by two, just like this, just like here. Two rows, just two by two. Either row, doesn't matter to me. Okay, yeah, there's one. Come over here. There you go. You can go that one. You go around that one. Okay, so the first two people come up. And when I ask you the question, I want you to shout out the answer that you think it is, okay? All right, come up and look right here. And you come up and look right there. Come up close. Who do you see?
Me.
Right, good job. I don't see me. Oh, yes, I do. Next two. Okay, go stand over there. Don't go away because I got something for you. Who do you see? All right, say it loud because these people aren't going to be able to hear you if you whisper. Okay, stand over there. Who's the next two? Stand over. If you're done, go over there. If you already saw it. No, I think you already looked, right? So go stand over there. There you go. Come here, you two. You tell me who you see in the mirror. Come up close. Who do you see? All right, good. You guys, you're all seeing the same people. Well, not really, but you're saying the same thing. All right, come on up. Who do you see? Yes. All right, last two. Come on up. See if you see anybody different. Have you saw it yet? Yeah, you've done this, right? Go ahead. Look up. Look in the right there. What do you see? Okay, well, look down. Go long. You're a little tall. There you go. Who do you see? Me. All right. Very good. Now, stand on the side a second because I want all these folks to look because I have something I want to share with them. Okay? This beautiful cross that normally hangs inside the entryway was made by Ann Schnortz. She told me something a while back that I didn't even realize. Okay? What else do you see on the cross?
Words.
Words. Okay. These are the words they put on top of Jesus' cross when they crucified him, that he is the King of Kings. Do you see anything else? Colors, yes. And a heart, okay? Because Jesus loved us so much that he died for us. But the reason that there's a mirror here and a mirror there and a mirror there is who do you see in the mirror when you look?
Us.
Yes, because Jesus died for
us.
And our sins put Jesus on the cross. Jesus died to remove sin, but the sins of humanity, the bad things that people have done, Jesus died on the cross so that he could forgive people who ask him to forgive us, and he will make us a part of his family. That's why the cross is so important. That's why it's so important the cross is empty. But on this day, we're not celebrating the cross. What are we celebrating? We're celebrating that Jesus did die on the cross, but that he came back to life because he conquered death and sin and says, if you follow me, then I will forgive you of your sins and I will come into your life. Pretty neat, huh? Let's pray. God, I pray for these young ones and adults alike that we recognize that Easter is not a legend or a tradition or religion. Lord, what we do is we remember your sacrifice of love for us and that you provide redemption if we will just embrace it in Jesus.
Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. You got two hands, so grab two eggs. One in each hand. They all got stuff in them. Don't worry about shaking them. Trust me. They're all none are empty. Just grab one. Here you go. Go ahead, grab one. One for each hand. Make sure you got two when you leave. And you go back to sit down when you're done. Grab it. All right. You got your two? Go ahead, hurry up, because we've got church going on here. Yeah. All right, good job. No, you don't get an egg. Those are mine. I'm going to ask you to stand as we continue to worship our Lord together.
Scripture, that Lord, the song we just sang would be a true conviction of our heart, that we hunger for you, because Lord, you are the only one that provides real hope and eternal hope. You are the only one, Lord Jesus, that died on the cross to pay for the penalty of our sins. You're the only one, Lord, that will take residence in our life if we invite you to do so and confess our sins before you. Thank you, Father, for that kind of love. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to begin sharing a reading, and it's a few paragraphs, so please stay with me. This is an introduction
to a little booklet called The Agony of the Cross by Nikki Gumbel. Nikki Gumbel is the one that helped create and promote the Alpha Ministries, which we do in our church, currently actually doing in our church. And this chapter is called The Questions of Life, Chapter 3, The Agony of the Cross. Jesus came as a substitute. He endured crucifixion for us. Cicero described the crucifixion as the most cruel and hideous of tortures. Jesus was stripped and tied to a whipping post. He was flogged with 4 or 5 thongs of leather interwoven with sharp, jagged bone and lead. Eusebius, the 3rd century church historian, described Roman flogging in these terms: the sufferer's veins were laid bare and the very muscles and sinews and bowels of the victim were open to exposure. Jesus was then taken to the praetorium, where a crown of thorns were thrust upon his head. He was mocked by a battalion of about 600 men and hit about the face and the head. He was then forced to carry a heavy crossbar across his bleeding shoulders until he collapsed, and Simon of Cyrene was forced into carrying it for him. When they reached the site of the crucifixion, he was again stripped naked. He was laid on the cross, and 6-inch nails were driven into his forearms just above the wrist. His knees were twisted sideways so that the ankles could be nailed above the tibia and the Achilles tendon. And he was lifted up on the cross, which was then dropped into a socket in the ground. And there he was left to hang in intense heat and unbearable thirst, exposed to the ridicule of the crowd. And he hung in unthinkable pain for 6 hours while his life slowly drained away. Yet the worst part of his suffering was not the physical trauma or torture of the crucifixion, nor even the emotional pain of being rejected by the world and deserted by his friends. It was the spiritual agony of being cut off from his Father for us as he carried our sins. Jesus' victory was total. He died not for one person, but for us all, and it was costly. In all 4 Gospels, we hear that Jesus' agony in the Garden of Gethsemane, alone, crying to the Father, "Abba, Father, take this cup from me. Yet not what I will, but what you will." Raniero Cantalamessa, preacher to the papal household, writes, "In the Bible, the image of the cup almost always evokes the idea of God's wrath against sin, wherever sin exists. God's judgment cannot be focused upon it. Otherwise, God would reach a compromise with sin, and the very distinction itself between good and evil would no longer exist. Now, Jesus in Gethsemane is man, made sin, Christ. It is written, died for sinners. He died in their place, and not only in their favor, he is therefore responsible for all, the guilty one before God. It is against him that God's wrath is revealed, and that is what drinking the cup at communion means. On the cross, the powers of evil were disarmed, though. On the cross, death and the demonic were defeated. On the cross, God revealed his love for us. On the cross, he is crucified God. And on the cross, Jesus sets the example of self-sacrificing love. In Good Friday service, I mentioned this, so I'm going to mention it again, because I had one of our parishioners say that she had a conversation with someone here right in our own community that didn't understand or know what Easter was all about. Why do we do this? What's the celebration for? On television, there was a, and this is what I mentioned Tuesday night, Friday night, on the television, there was a interviewer walking around on the streets interviewing people about Easter, Good Friday. Do you know what this is about? And for the most part, what they showed was people didn't know. Maybe it was the birth of Christ. Maybe it was some fun celebration from the past. Some people just said, I don't know. Some tried to answer the questions because they had kind of a faint knowledge of it. Even the interviewer, when he came back, and this is the odd thing, the interviewer and the host, after they watched this, they were kind of mocking, or at least joking, about how could anybody not know what Good Friday and Easter was in the world, our world, United States, which was a Christian nation in its upbringing, so to speak. And then the interviewer said, well, you know, that one about the Mount Calvary, that caught me off guard. I didn't know about that or where it was. And I thought, why are you laughing at the people you just interviewed? Because you got the same ignorance in part that they have. We have, in our culture and in actually the culture of the world, we have tried to be so inclusive of people and their belief system, and we are to be respectful and accepting of all people. Don't get me wrong. But there is only one person that died for the sins of the world. There are different approaches to how do we get to heaven, but heaven isn't the goal. Heaven is merely the location where it says God has his throne. The goal, the reason Jesus came to die for the sins of humanity, was so that we would have a means to be reconciled in relationship back with God again. Because that was violated and broken in the Garden of Eden. And so God loved us so much that he sent his son Jesus to be our Savior. Now, there's no dispute. People that dispute that Jesus was not historically real, the scholars and historians, whether they're religious or anything, will say, no, he was a real person. You can't deny that he was a man that walked the earth, that he was put on trial, that he was crucified in the cruelest way. That is indisputable. What people dispute is coming back to life, being God incarnate. That's what they dispute. And yet if you read in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it goes through a litany of people almost to say, here are witnesses. And it's exactly what it says. These people, they encountered Jesus Christ after his death, walking on the earth prior to his ascension. I watched an interview, actually I posted it on our Facebook page for the church, if you haven't seen it yet, but somebody was asking Robbie Zacharias a question, and he's a great apologetist for the Christian faith, and they were asking him a question about, well, there's all these different faiths out there, and isn't the fact that just getting, you know, looking to God and recognizing God and so forth and so on, and he said, no, this is the difference, is that Jesus is God incarnate. The difference is Jesus died for everybody. Nobody else did that. That his, because of his perfection, because of his holiness, it was considered an acceptable gift by God for the sins of all the world. And Jesus is unique in that way. And in 1 Corinthians 15, where it talks about these different people saw him, it was unique. It was the testimony, and he said that a different guy gave an illustration where he went and he talked to two people from a college that he was a part of, and they were both in the humanities religion kind of scholastic area of life, and one when he asked the question of that gap between Jesus' death and Jesus' life, how do you account for that, those testimonies of those people? And one said, that's not my department, so I don't even stop to think about it. And the other one said mass hallucination, which is extremely easy to counteract or speak against, because these people weren't all in one area at the same time. And these people, usually if a person is hallucinating, they don't all hallucinate the same exact thing. It's because they're hallucinating. No one is going to be able to convince anybody else that Jesus Christ is God incarnate. That comes through the conviction of the Holy Spirit, and then our faith to accept that, knowing that God is greater than anyone or anything. I want to share with you four images that describe what Jesus did on the cross, and then we're going to get to the resurrection, because that's why we're here. The image of the temple. The Old Testament laid down laws of sacrifice. They said, this is how you're going to sacrifice. Had nothing to do at the time with Jesus, but it was a precursor to Jesus. They established the laws of animal sacrifices so that it would become very common and understandable what a sacrifice for their sins, their wrongdoings, or whatever were. And so the Old Testament practices of sacrifices was the beginning, or was setting up the one ultimate sacrifice that would be done for us, Jesus Christ. Hebrews 10:4 says, "For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins." Only Jesus can do that. But the people were supposed to come in the sacrifices and at least acknowledge they knew that they had done wrong. In the New Testament, only the blood of Christ is our substitute. 1 John 1:7 says, "But we walk in the light, Jesus, as he himself is in the light. We have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin." Only Christ is our substitute. And then there's the image of the marketplace. This is a picture of debt. We know what debt is. Most people in this room are living in debt. Not everybody, hallelujah for that, but most of us are. Some are living in huge debt, and some are living in minor debt. And if you paid off your house and your car's paid off and you got no debt, hallelujah. But you're the exception to the rule in the United States of America anyway. In Matthew 18:23, it talks about the debt that we have, the debt of sin. "For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. And when he had begun to settle them, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. But since he did not have the means to repay, Lord commanded him to be sold along with his wife and children and all that he had, and repayment to be made." The example there is the example of debt. That even back 2,000 years ago, people still borrowed. Unfortunately, back in those days, the way you paid it back was you either worked for it and paid it back, or you became a slave until you paid your debt. But here's the picture of redemption, being redeemed from the debt that we owe. In our case, it's the debt of sin. Mark 10:45, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom or payment for many," for our debt. John 3:8-36, if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. Free from what? Free from the debt of sin. What is the punishment of living in sin willingly, or being born with it and just ignoring that it's there and going on our own way? Wage of sin is death, meaning eternal separation from God for all eternity. That means we're never reconciled with God. And so when eternity comes, we do not get to spend the rest of eternity with God, serving God, but rather we spend it in God's enemy's camp, which is Satan, and hell has been reserved for him. So we preach the good news of his death and resurrection to remind people that God's come to redeem us, to save us, to pay the penalty for our sin through the image of the marketplace. And then there's the image of court, the picture of justification. Romans 5:1 says, "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." You see, it's not that we do something. in order to earn that reconciliation with God. Jesus already did it. But by faith, we must embrace it. We must ask God to forgive us of the sins that we have occurred through life and that we were born with, that we've chosen to be a part of. Ask Him to forgive us of those sins and embrace Jesus as Savior and surrender to Him. And then follow the path that He has set for us that is the best of interests by God. Therefore, having been justified by faith then in Christ, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And then through that court image then, there's justification. Then there's the picture of pardon. If we do embrace Jesus, have faith in Him, as the Scripture describes, in Him we have redemption through His blood. Again, there's the cross. The forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of His grace. That's from Ephesians 1:7. In other words, our sin has been forgiven according to the riches of His grace because of the work that He accomplished on the cross. And the final image is the image of home. This is received into the family. This is the goal, not heaven, not a location, but rather in a position of being a part of God's family. Ephesians 1:5 says, He predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to Himself according to the kind intention of His will. He has predestined. He has looked forward and prepared the way for us to abandon our sins and call unto Him for salvation. He has made that possible so that we could enter into that relationship as sons and daughters of Jesus Christ, so that the restored relationship will be with a Father God. 2 Corinthians 5:19 says, God was in Christ reconciling the world to Himself, not counting their trespasses against them. He has committed to us the word of reconciliation. This is what He desires for us, to be reconciled to God the Father through God's Son. But the cross is not complete without the resurrection. If it was just a martyr, somebody that just died and said, well, I died for you, but then that was it, then he would be just another man, just another individual, just someone that came up with this neat idea. I've got this plan in place, and so if you just follow me, even though I'm dead now, you know, follow my history, you'll be okay. The cross is not complete without the resurrection. 1 Corinthians 15:3-4 says, I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that He was buried and He was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. Let me ask you a question. What Scriptures? This was written shortly after Jesus was resurrected. We're talking about the Old Testament, Genesis to Malachi. Because in the book of Psalms and in the book of Isaiah and some of the books, there are the prophecies of the Messiah foretold to come. And as the New Testament is unfolded, we see that those prophecies are fulfilled right down to the letter of where and when, so to speak. Jesus would be born in Bethlehem. He was. Jesus would be died on the cross of Calvary. And He was. They didn't mention the name Jesus. They said Messiah. But we see that it's fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And so He was buried and He was raised on the third day. Jesus' resurrection solidifies victory over sin, Satan, and death. It's not to say that we don't see evidence of sin, or we see evidence of Satan, or we see evidence of sin, Satan, and death. Obviously, those things, we still see them, but those we see are with the eyes that are limited to the life that we live, the life from birth to whatever age we die. What Jesus has done is He has conquered for eternity these things, and so when we surrender to Christ and when we give our life to Him and when He forgives us and adopts us into His family, then we are eternally above sin, Satan, and death. That stuff may try to touch us, and physically it will, but eternally we are above it and we'll move beyond it. And one day when we're in paradise with God, it'll have no opportunity whatsoever to try to overwhelm us. And then Jesus' resurrection testifies of future resurrection of his family. In other words, just as Jesus was raised from the dead bodily, for all who are followers of Christ, we look forward with expectancy to that day after we die, that one day when Jesus returns, we too will be raised bodily form with a new body, a glorified body, but it's one that we can look forward to spend with our Father. 1 Corinthians 15:50 says, "Now I say this, brothers, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, die, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. But when this perishable will have put on the imperishable, and the mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin. The power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not in vain in the Lord." We can look forward, and I do as a believer, look forward to that day. If I die, I die, because I know I'm going to get an imperishable body. I know I'm going to be, I'm already immortal because of Christ who is in me. The human frame may die, but the soul, that God will take that human frame and then make it perfect, will be awesome on that day of his return. Redemption. And the message is this: from the cross to the tomb, the empty tomb, redemption is available today. The one reason it's available is because Jesus is mighty to save. He is not some individual that came up with an idea or a concept and said, "Follow me and your life will be better." He is God incarnate, and he said, "I have come and I have performed the work and the sacrifice so that you who are my creation can be redeemed from sin and spend all of eternity with God, serving him, loving him, in a new heaven and a new earth. But that day must come before your death or before Jesus comes." I'm going to ask the worship team to come. As they come, I just want to speak to you. Let's go into prayer mode. Father God, I just pray that you will be with all of us who are here. It is great, Lord, you know, a lot of us get dressed up. We get on our Sunday best for Easter. We have really nice meals. We invite family to come. All those things are fantastic. But Lord, the day, this day, is to remind us of the ultimate sacrifice and the glorious sacrifice of God incarnate, Jesus Christ, Son of God, Son of Man, who died for us and took on the wrath of God so we don't have to. So Lord, I pray for anyone that might be here today that has never surrendered to you. But this morning, your Holy Spirit speaking to them and saying, "You know, I love you. I died for you. I want you to know what it is to be saved from sin, to walk in a new life with new vision, new understanding here on earth, and also have a secure place with the Father in eternity." If there's anyone that wants that, even while your heads are still bowed and your eyes are still closed, if this is something you feel you want, then just raise your hand at this moment. And I'll pray a prayer and you can repeat it quietly so it's yours. But if you want to give your life to God today, this is your opportunity. Anyone? Just raise your hand. While your heads are still bowed, your eyes are closed. Anybody want to receive Christ today and ask Christ to forgive you of your sin? Father God, be with us also who have already made that commitment, This is a reminder that you expect us to walk as children of God, to love when people revile us and rebuke us, when people say and do mean things against us, whether it's because of our faith or just because we're in the vicinity, that we act like Jesus before them, turn the other cheek and forgive and help those who are hurting. And Lord, let our life be a living example of Christ who is in us, to demonstrate the joy of our resurrection in Jesus Christ. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you please stand as we sing our final song together?
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, kindness of the Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save, He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures, and fill my life again. Give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender.
Now I surrender.
Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Hallelujah. You liked that, didn't you? Hallelujah. Hey, have a wonderful Easter. Go in God's peace, because He is risen.